heavens rejoice, let the earth be glad. Let the people of God sing His praise all over the land. Everyone in the valley, come and lift your voice. All those on the mountaintop, be glad. Shout for joy. Rise up and praise Him. He deserves our love. Rise up and praise Him. Worship the Holy One with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Rise up and praise Him. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let the people of God sing His praise all over the land. Everyone in the valley, come and lift your voice. All those on the mountaintop, be glad. Shout for joy. Rise up and praise Him. He deserves our love. Rise up and praise Him. Worship the Holy One with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Rise up and praise Him.
Into this place, and we give you praise and honor. You are so worthy and holy and mighty, and we love you so much. We pray that you would be honored with us this morning, that we would give to you all that you deserve. Come and be welcome here this morning in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, welcome, everybody. Man, it's good to see you again. It's been nice, you know, having a couple weeks off and everything like that, but it's good to be back. It's really good to be back. So if you are visiting with us, welcome. Would like everybody to do me a favor. If you've got a bulletin with you, if you grabbed one of those when you came in, if you look on the back of it, there is a welcome card on there, a communication card. Please take a moment, tear that off, and fill that out. We'd love everybody to do that. And then in a little while, when we receive the offering, you can go ahead and put that in the offering basket when it comes by. And if it's your first day here, we would certainly like to make sure you got some information about us. So when the service is over, if you'd make your way to the front of the sound booth, there are bags there. You'll see these white bags. Grab one of those. That's for you, just for information's sake, for you to have a better understanding of who we are and why we're here and what we do and those types of things. A couple of things I want to make you aware of. We have an opportunity coming up this next Saturday as a body to come alongside of another family here of this church, the Pickards. We're going to be helping to clean up. They got a big yard cleanup that needs to happen. And so we're going to be meeting at their house about 8 o'clock on Saturday. If you can't make it at 8 o'clock, that's okay. Come when you can come in the morning. But we've got a large dumpster we're going to be getting, and many hands makes light work. So if you can come out there and help us with that, we'd really, really appreciate that. That's this Saturday. Also, we are getting ready next month to do our baptisms, but we like to get that set up ahead of time. So if you are a believer in Jesus Christ and you've never been baptized, or have been baptized maybe as an infant and you don't recall it, it's something that you're going, man, I would like to do that for myself. Man, we'd love to baptize you. So that's coming up on the 15th of next month. We go down to a park. We go down to Gross Park and have a great time. We have a potluck picnic together, and then we go down to the lake and do the baptisms, and there's all sorts of stuff there for kids to do and things of that nature too. So please plan on making that a huge, huge thing for us and in the lives of people who are believers. We want to be able to come together as a body and support them and to celebrate with them what God has been doing in their life. So that's coming up. We are going to be partnering with an organization, and I'm going to make sure within this next week we try to get you some more information, maybe in a flyer or whatever we do. But there's an organization in this area. I don't know if you're familiar with them. It's called Bridge Nuevo. Bridge Nuevo. I was part of the initial group helping to set that up. Here's the nuts and bolts of it. It's reaching out to teen moms, okay, mothers in crisis. Certainly their boyfriends as well, but we use the moms to kind of get into talking with the boyfriends, right? And it's one of those things where a lot of teen mothers have a lot of different needs. And we want to, as a church, open our doors to be able to help meet those needs. And so what Bridge Nuevo is doing is partnering with a bunch of local churches. And they go into these churches, they ask these churches to kind of join in with them, and then each church chooses three things that they're going to do, three things that they will commit to be able to do. And they kind of give you a list to guide you. They also let us kind of do our own thing. What kind of things do we think will help to reach out to these young ladies that we as a congregation can do? And then if a young lady, what happens is, you'll notice this in a number of weeks. I don't know how long it takes, but there's going to be some flags that will be hanging out at the end of the driveway. And one of them says, you know, we love teen moms, right? And then the other one says, hope and help can be found here. All right, so other churches partnering have the same kind of thing. These teen moms see these flags. They go into the churches, hey, I have this need. Now, if that particular church can meet that need, they will. If they can't, they call the network. And the network says, well, we know that this church down the street or this church over here is doing this thing. You know, then there's all sorts of things. There's classes for mothering. There's babysitting services. Some places are even, some of the people in the congregations are saying, hey, we're willing to adopt. So there's so many different things. Some are offering to help, you know, repair cars and provide automobiles. I mean, it's crazy. But it's a wonderful ministry that we're going to be partnering with as a church. And so if that's something that you would like to see how you can be involved in that too, hopefully as a congregation we'll be involved, but maybe you have a real heart and passion for teen moms and would like to be a part of that. You can certainly talk to me. I'm going to put you in touch with Mike and Robin Skytema too, because they're going to be the ones as the point people for that here. But it's a great opportunity, and you're going to hear more about it. But I just want you to be aware something that's coming down the pike here for us as a congregation. So other than that, there's certainly other items for you to look at in your bulletin. Please do that. Kids, as you're getting ready for your time of kids' worship today, why don't you come on up?
All right, and as these kids are coming up, I'll kind of briefly explain what we like to do for anybody who's new or visiting. What we like to do is we like to send home a box with one of the kids, and the box says, what is this? And they are supposed to put an item inside this box, and then one of us is supposed to somehow relate this. Okay, I'll move down here then. We're supposed to relate this to a message about God and how this item might relate to something about him. Join the group, why don't you? Yeah, be careful with it. It's in bubble wrap. I was hoping the bubble wrap would be the message. This is what we got. Wow. What is it?
It's a road with lights, and God lights our path.
Whoa. He gave the message and everything. Look at that. I didn't even have to. Nice. Did you guys catch that? You built it, didn't you? Yeah, he built it. He wanted to give the message already. He's coming for your spot. Good. Yeah. Did you guys see? Okay, so you guys see what it is, right? Did you hear what Jethro said it was? Okay, he built this. It's got a road, and it's got lights, all right? And the whole purpose of the lights is so that it can light the path. What happens if those lights aren't turned on? It doesn't what?
It doesn't light the path.
Okay, cool. That's awesome. All right? Yeah, it doesn't light the path. If there's nothing, if it's just darkness and there's no light, how do we know which way we're going to go? We don't, do we? Right? But God has come down. He's provided a light for us. Who can tell me who's the light? Shout it out. Who can say it? Jesus. Perfect Sunday school answer right there. I like it. Right? Yeah, Jesus. God provided Jesus to show us the light to find our way back to him. All right? He has come down and provided light so that we can make it back to him. My hope and my prayer is that each one of you accepts God's call. You see that light and that you walk towards it, and that God illuminates your life and that he illuminates your path. But the Bible says that when God shows us which path to take, we are the ones that have to take that path. All right? If we decide not to follow God's path, we're not going to live in light at all. We're going to live in darkness. Okay? God has provided the light. Now we need to walk in that light. Otherwise, we'll be completely in darkness. Okay? Cool. Nice job. I'm going to give that back to you. I'll go ahead and pray for you, and then I will bring the box back to your teacher, and then they will hand it out to one of you. Sound good? All right. Father God, thank you so much for this beautiful morning. And I want to thank you so much for each one of these kids. I want to pray that you meet with them this morning, that you continue to teach them, you continue to guide them through the words that their teachers are going to use, through the ways that their parents teach them at home. Father, I just pray that you continue to show your light to them, and that they choose to walk in that light and not in darkness. Father, I just pray that your salvation is granted to each and every single one of them. And I pray that as a result of that salvation, that they go and they make more disciples and share that light with other people so that more people can come to know of your goodness through the way that you have interacted in their lives. Father, I pray that you bless their time and you bless their morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All right, well, before we go to prayer, just a couple corrections. I want to make sure that I get that clearly. The baptisms are on the 13th of August, not the 15th, so don't show up on Tuesday. You know, it'll be on that Sunday on the 13th. And this ministry is not just teen moms, it is single moms. So of any age, single moms is that I'll be reaching out. So I'll make sure you understand what that's going to be too. Well, let's go talk to God, shall we? Father, you are such a good God. And, man, we wake up, you know, Scripture tells us your mercies are new every morning. And we certainly can experience that. And I pray, Father, that we can cling to your truth today. That no matter what our world looks like, our society, our communities, whatever it looks like on any given day, we can trust you. And so, Father, I pray that we will lean into you, that we will put our burdens at your feet, that we will embrace you, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will just surround us and cover us with comfort, with direction, with hope. Lord, may we realize that everything we need is found in you. Father, I'm so grateful, Lord, for the things that you've been doing in our lives. The reports that I get from people of what you're doing, and when you look at a situation and you go, man, who but God? This isn't by accident. And we can celebrate that you're still moving, that you're still doing. And Lord, we know from Scripture that that's true even when we don't see it. Today, Lord, some of us are sitting here struggling, to be honest, just struggling. Life seems to be, you know, caving in, and the pressure seems to be high. And Lord, today, for those, they just really need a sense of your Holy Spirit. So I pray, Lord, that you will make yourself known to them today. Bring hope. Father, I thank you for the many ways that you have provided for us. For most of us, if not all of us in this room, Lord, we are able to have food on a table. We have a roof over our head. Got up this morning breathing. You provide us with the opportunity to be able to be clothed. You provide opportunities out there for employment so that we can go out and earn we can go out there and earn money to be able to buy things Lord, you give us opportunities for rest and renewal where we can just unplug and to recharge our batteries. You give us people in our lives who love us, who will encourage us. Father, we give you thanks for these things. Most importantly, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who was willing to give his life up so that we could have life. Who, through his power and your power, Lord, was able to resurrect from the dead, to overcome death and to conquer evil, so that we can enjoy victory over sin as well, and that we can have an eternity to look forward to in your presence. So today, Lord, we gather together as a body of believers to worship you, to acknowledge what you have done in our lives and to give you praise that you are worthy of. And we do it in so many ways. And so, Lord, right now, we just want to continue our worship by giving back to you a portion of that which you allowed us to earn. We say thank you. We ask, Lord, that you give us wisdom in how to use the resources so that we can continue to further what you have given us to do here in this community and around the world. And we ask, Lord, that you are honored in everything we say and do. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We will receive the offering at this time. As we do, remember to please put that communication card in the basket when it comes by. Let's stand to our feet as we continue on in our worship this morning. You know, in worship services all around the world, when people gather like this, we sing. And one of the reasons we do is because Scripture tells us to sing. Okay, so it's a command for us to do so. But music is a way for us to take what we know to be true, to express it in a way that connects what's in our head with our heart. And so I want to encourage you this morning as you sing to worship from your head and from your heart.
Found I know can save. Yeah.
The sun cannot compare to the glory of your love. There is no shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne. Before the Holy One of Heaven. And it's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy, Lord, I come. I bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. The sun cannot compare to the glory of your shadow in your presence. No mortal man would dare to stand before your throne, before the Holy One of Heaven. And it's only by your blood, and it's only through your mercy. Bring an offering of worship to my King. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. The Lord, I bring an offering to you. I bring an offering. No one on earth deserves the praises that I sing. Jesus, may you receive the honor that you're due. Oh Lord, I bring an offering to you. Oh Lord, I bring an offering.
Father, we come this morning to bring you an offering. And we pray, Lord, that it will be acceptable and pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, it is indeed good to be back. And while we were gone on vacation, which, by the way, most of the things that we had planned to do on vacation, we didn't get to do. That's how that turned out. I'll spare you the long story of it. But we didn't get to stay as long as we were going to. We didn't get to do a lot of things that we were going to do. And probably that's why it was the most restful. Because we pretty much had a list of things. And it's nice to just be able to slow down and to relax. But while we were on vacation, we had the opportunity to do something that all of you normally get the opportunity to do. We don't get this opportunity very often. We got to choose where we were going to go to worship on a Sunday. I don't get that choice every Sunday, right? So it was something new for me, and it was really kind of exhilarating to me. It kind of refreshed my soul a little bit, but it gave me a glimpse, a little bit of an insight as to what other people go through, what they think as they're trying to choose where they're going to worship on a Sunday morning. I felt like a kid in a candy store, you know? I had so many choices, and they were all good, and they were going to be good for me kind of a thing, you know? Like, that's what I thought, right, as a kid. But it came down to the fact that we had to make a choice. We had to choose. Where are we going to go? So what is it that was going to determine our choice? What makes for the perfect worship experience? That's what I want to explore this morning. We're going to be looking at Romans today, Romans chapter 1. I promise you, you probably have never read this section of Scripture as a worship section of Scripture, but we're going to today. Romans chapter 1, you're in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, book of Acts, then Romans. All right, Romans chapter 1, we're going to put it up on the screen as well. Well, we're looking at Romans, we're going to start with verse 18. We're going to go ahead and read right on through verse 32. But God shows his anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. They know the truth about God because he's made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and the sky. Through everything God made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God. Yes, they knew God, but they wouldn't worship him as God or even give him thanks. And they began to think up foolish ideas of what God was like. And as a result, their minds became dark and confused. Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. And instead of worshiping the glorious, ever-living God, they worshiped idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. So, God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. And as a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worshiped and served the created things that God created instead of the Creator himself, who's worthy of eternal praise. Amen. That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the women turned against natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, he abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do the things that should never be done. Their lives became full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and gossip. They are backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, and boastful. They invent new ways of sinning, and they disobey their parents. They refuse to understand, break their promises, are heartless, and have no mercy. They know God's justice requires that those who do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them too. So what's the problem as it's being unfolded here in this passage in Romans? I mean, right away, our eyes tend to zero in on the inappropriate relationships between men and women. We see men and women having what Scripture defines as shameful and unnatural relations with one another. And in light of the current sexual climate in our culture, where this has been exploded into all sorts of sexual perversion that is outside of God's original design, we see this as a proof positive text that God opposes homosexuality, which is true. But if that's what we zero in on, then we are guilty of missing the real point of this passage. The inappropriate sexual relationships that were taking place were not the problem. They were just one of many manifestations of the problem. The real problem was found there in verse 25 and 26. It said that they traded the truth about God for a lie. And because they traded the truth about God for a lie, what did they do? It altered their worship. It said they worshiped and served the things that God created instead of the Creator himself, who's worthy to be eternally praised. And it says that that is why God abandoned them to do the shameful things that they were doing. Because they opted not to recognize him as God or to worship him as God. Now, why is that a problem? Well, it's a problem because God clearly said when he laid down his laws through Moses, he told the people, we read in Exodus chapter 20, he says, you must not have any other God but me. You must not make for yourself an idol of any kind or any image in the heavens or on the earth or in the sea. You must not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God who will not tolerate your affections for any other gods. They had a problem with the truth. And the truth created a worship problem. Worship, as it's defined in the dictionary, worship is the expression of reverence and adoration for a deity. That last word is key. Adoration and respect for a deity. Worship is an outward expression of what's being experienced inside of a person. And that expression reveals the object of your worship. It's obvious, or it should be, and it should demonstrate the level of respect and adoration for that object. And that object should be, by definition, a deity, which is another way of saying not humans, not any kind of object out there. And according to Scripture, not just any deity is going to do, but perfect worship centers on God as the object. You want to experience perfect worship, you need to begin by centering God as the object that we worship. Now in verse 21, it says that the people of that area wouldn't do that. They refused to do that. They would not make God the object of their worship, and as a result, their minds became dark and confused. You know, when God stops being the object of your worship, when human beings and human interests start becoming the object of our worship, darkness and confusion begins to reign. And as a result, not only will there be all sorts of sexual perversions and confusion, which we see in our world today, but according to the Apostle Paul in verses 29 through 32, when you stop making God the object of your worship, people will become full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and gossip. Stop making God as the object of your worship, and they become backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, boastful. They invent new ways of sinning, and they disobey their parents. They refuse to understand. When you stop making God the object of your worship, you're going to get to a point you just refuse to understand the truth. They refuse to understand. They break their promises. They're heartless. They are people who show other people no mercy. They know that God's justice requires that those who do those things deserve to die, but they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them too. Now I know we desperately want to apply these kind of things to our culture and to nod our heads in agreement. Yep. That's exactly what they do. But this can be applied anywhere across the board, and unfortunately, it can even be applied to individuals who make up the church. One of the biggest knocks on the church these days is that it is looking more and more like the culture that it's supposed to be called out from and distinguished from. Is that true? I mean, is that a fair knock on the church? Because the only way that that can be true, according to Scripture, is if the church is shifting or losing focus of its object of worship, which, of course, has to be a deity, more specifically God, not other people. Is our worship shifting or wandering off course? You know, in the book of Numbers, specifically the chapters 28 through 29, God lays out some instructions of what he sees as perfect worship of himself. In this section, you will see a bunch of different types of offerings. There are daily offerings, there are Sabbath offerings, there are monthly offerings, Passover offerings, Festival of Harvest offerings, Festival of Trumpets offerings, Days of Atonement offerings, and Festival of Shelter offerings, which in and of itself has 8 days of special types of offerings. Each one of these offerings had very specific details attached to them as to what kind of animal you had to sacrifice, how many animals you had to sacrifice, when in the day you had to sacrifice them. And each one of these sacrifices also came along with liquid offerings, which had very specific measurements as to what was to be included in the liquid offering. Every offering after the daily offerings includes this phrase in Scripture. This particular offering is in addition to the regular burnt offering and its accompanying liquid offering. In other words, you had the daily offerings, the daily burnt offerings, but you also had Sabbath offerings. And if the Sabbath offering happened to fall on, well, it's going to fall on a day, right? So you have to do the daily offering and the Sabbath offering. If that Sabbath offering happens to fall during Passover, you got to do the Passover offerings and the Sabbath offerings and the daily offerings. You get where I'm going with this? I mean, some days you can have just multiple offerings that you got to be giving. And each one of these offerings requires the same thing. In order for these people to be able to offer these offerings, they had to grow them. They had to feed them. They had to butcher them and gather them. That took an awful lot of effort on their part. It took an awful lot of forethought on their part. It took a lot of preparation. All of it, before they even showed up at the temple for their corporate worship, before they even got there, they had to do all this forethought going into what they were offering. They would come to the temple having already done the appropriate preparation in order to bring with them something to give. See, perfect worship requires preparation and giving. This is the foundation of perfect worship, the perfect worship of God. So here's the question. Do you come to a worship service that's designed for him, having prepared ahead of time with the purpose of bringing something to give him? Is that how you came here today? Have you spent all this time leading up to this time that you walked in the door just preparing to come to give God something today? How much forethought and effort have you given before showing up for a worship service, whether it's here or anywhere else? Do you come for the purpose of bringing something to God or receiving something? You know, a couple of common sentiments that you hear surrounding worship services. One would be, man, that was an awesome service. Man, that was awesome. Or you get its counterpart. I didn't get anything out of that. What do they mean by that? And why is that the case? Why does somebody think it's awesome? Why does somebody claim I got nothing out of it? Well, we've got to remember that one of the results of not maintaining God as the object of our worship is darkness and confusion, highlighted by a misconception of who God is and what the worship of Him is designed for. We saw this breakdown in the 80s and the 90s. I mean, who here remembers the 80s and 90s? Right? Isn't that all right, right? Sorry, you may want to, may not want to. That's all right. In churches back in the 80s and 90s, things began to shift. You might remember this. They began to shift. And we introduced a new term into our churches, right? It was called seeker. Seeker, right? The term given to somebody who's looking for hope and meaning and purpose in their life. They don't know exactly where to find it, but they're searching. They're seeking. And in the 80s and 90s, we created what was called seeker-sensitive services. What that meant was that the service itself was basically addressing and talking to primarily believers, but it was keeping in mind the fact that there might be seekers present. So they tailored their services accordingly. Then came the seeker-oriented services. This was one that was geared entirely to the non-believers. They shifted everything they did to try to appeal to the non-believers to, quote-unquote, get them in the door. It was all about atmosphere and the experience. Churches started making their weekly services all as their outreach evangelism rather than their time to come together as believers to show their respect and adoration and praise and gratitude to God Almighty. Music began to shift at that time. Began to shift from the focus of God to the focus of people. More emphasis was placed on the emotion that a song could invoke and the simplicity of the lyrics, as opposed to the oft-confusing language and rhythm of hymns. And believe me, it was a welcomed addition. It was nice to be able to worship if you were somebody who sings the hymns and you're like, man, what on earth am I singing? I can't even understand a language, right? Now you got these songs, it's in a language you understand, and it's in this music and this style that you understand and appreciate, and it's appealing. It's connecting the heart and the head. In the midst of that, in order to continue the appeal, the styles change. And bands that you're used to seeing at concerts and type things, they replaced the organ playing, the guy standing in the pulpit, waving his hand, you know, to keep the rhythm type of thing. Bands started replacing that, you know, and to some people's lament, words that were held in a book that you could see and you could follow notes were replaced and put up on screens, things like that, just how we do it here. And in the process, the non-churched became much more comfortable in our services. And as predicted, numbers began to climb in the churches. Now, let me be clear. There's absolutely nothing wrong with bands. And there's nothing wrong with them using their giftedness to rock it out on a Sunday morning. Nothing wrong with that at all. There's nothing wrong with tapping into people's emotions. God gave us emotions to be able to connect the head and the heart when we're worshiping, to be able to feel what we're saying to God. Nothing wrong with that. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with hymns. There's nothing wrong with an organ. There's nothing wrong with that stuff. Scripture tells us when we worship, we are to sing. Ephesians 5:19, it says psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs amongst yourself, and make music to the Lord in your hearts. David, one of the greatest authors of worship music in Scripture, tells us that we're supposed to worship with all sorts of instruments. And he says, don't be afraid to do it loudly. If you think I'm wrong, read Psalm 150. He says, do it with the cymbals, with the loud, crashing cymbals. Zach loves that verse. Truth is, folks, music style is a personal preference. Whichever way we choose to express our worship of God musically, perfect worship focuses on the object of the worship, not the style of it. I think I've shared this before. Let me give you an example. I was worshiping in a church where it was very eclectic, all sorts of music styles, all sorts of things. And one young man got up on stage for a special music number, and he was doing rap. Okay? I hate rap. Okay? And he's up there doing his thing, and I look over, and there's this 80-year-old woman with her eyes closed and her hands raised to the Lord. Now, I know it's not her thing. But it wasn't about the style to her. It was about the fact that God was moving in that young man's heart. And this is the style that speaks to this young man. And he was able to express his love and his adoration to his God in a worship service. He was given room to be able to use his giftedness to worship God the way that God had gifted him to. And she was worshiping that God. Oh, that more of our churches could be like that. You know, when worship's supposed to be about a deity, and a deity's not a human being, right? And therefore, it's not about us. It's not about us. It's not about how we feel. Worship should be about God and what pleases God, what brings Him honor. And when the object of your worship is focused on the style of it, when it's focused on the music or the speaker or the seating arrangements, you know, are they pews, are they comfortable chairs, are they whatever, you know, how are they seated, that type of thing. The atmosphere, you know, are the lights low, are the lights high, are the lights flashing, is there smoke, is there not smoke. Whenever the atmosphere, when you focus on all those things, we become the object. And when we become the object of worship, darkness and confusion follow. And then watch out. Let me give you just a small example. All right, Caleb, if you're back there, go ahead and just turn the guitar on a minute. This is a song that I led in worship years ago at that church that I just mentioned earlier. It's very simple. I'm only going to just play a couple lines of it, but it goes like this. I come expecting Jesus to meet me in this place. I come expecting to receive His mercy and His grace. Isn't that pretty? This is a pretty song. I mean, it's nice and mellow. You got the guitar picking emotionally. You're drawn in, tend to close your eyes and just, oh, yeah. I come expecting Jesus to meet me in this place. I come expecting to receive His mercy, His grace. But perfect worship isn't about you and I receiving anything. See, go back to that. The books of Numbers, again, 28 and 29, and all those details of all of those offerings, everything that God wanted them to do in preparation for coming to worship. In the midst of that, David writes, "You do not desire a sacrifice, or I would offer you one. You do not want a burnt offering." What? We just read all these different offerings where God's telling them, I want a burnt offering, I want the harvest offering, I want this offering, a Sabbath offering, Passover offering, this is what I want you to do, this is what I want you to do. What do you mean He doesn't want it? If He doesn't want it, why did He instruct them to give it? Because it was something deeper than the items. It was something deeper in the details. David says, the sacrifice that you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. Perfect worship begins with daily preparation of our heart prior to coming to a worship service. Jesus says in John chapter 4, true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. God desires a humble spirit, which means we don't make worship about us. God desires hearts that have taken the time to recognize their sinfulness in comparison to his holiness. And they're broken from it. That means confession and repentance. How many of you spent time this week before you even came here focusing on God's holiness in light of your sinfulness? And confessed to him and repented to him before even walking in the door. And from that position, he wants us to come prepared to bring to him our expressions of respect and gratitude, to lavish our honor on him for having already received his mercy and his grace. See, we shouldn't come to a worship service hoping Jesus will meet us here, because Scripture tells us if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, his Spirit has been placed inside your heart, which means he is here. He was with you before you even got here. You don't come here to meet him. And you don't come to receive something from God. You come to bring something to God in light of what you have already received, his grace and his mercy. That's what a worship service is supposed to be about. Perfect worship is determined by what we bring, not by what we get out of it. And when we start talking about whether or not we got something out of a worship service, we've determined that based on the music and how it made us feel, or whether the speaker was engaging and held our attention, or whether or not technology was used in a really cool way, or the arts were featured, or is there something for our kids? We become the object. Is the music, whether it's hymns, whether it's more contemporary music, whether it's done on a piano or a guitar or an organ, whether it's a hymn, whether it's done by a band, whether it's soft, whether it's loud, is the music focused on God? Then he's the object of the worship. Is the teaching true to Scripture? Then God is the object. Got to stop bellyaching about not getting our personal preferences when we don't get them. Are we focusing on God? Now, that's not to say that we don't get something out of it, okay? When I was a kid, I used to love going to birthday parties. I often get to go to birthday parties with my friends, and in order to get ready for that birthday party, my mom would take me shopping. We'd go pick something out. I mean, I was excited about that. You know, I knew my friends pretty well. I knew what they liked. I couldn't wait. So we would go, and we would purchase something, right? Well, and by we, I mean my mom, right? Would purchase something. We'd go home, wrap it up, and then, folks, I got to tell you, man, the anticipation level was just rising. I could not wait to get to that party and to give my friend what I had prepared to give him. And the joy that I got out of it was when I got to see his face once he received it. Had I not gone out and prepared for that party by preparing to give my friend something, I would have arrived at that party empty-handed. Probably would have been embarrassed. Consequently, I would have experienced a whole array of emotions that would have been very unpleasant and very uncomfortable. Maybe even made me feel empty. I would have found absolutely no joy in that party. You know, we always say that we are more blessed when we give, right? We do something for somebody, and people are like, man, they really appreciated that. But you turn around and you're like, what do you say? You know, I think I got more out of that than they did, right? That's how perfect worship should be. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, our goal is to please who? Him. Our goal is to please Him. But too often, our assessment of the quality of the worship that we participated in is based on whether or not we were pleased. If we feel like we're getting nothing out of a worship service, perhaps it has nothing to do with what did or did not take place during that service. Maybe the void that we're experiencing is the result of how we did or did not prepare ahead of time to bring something to God. Did you come expecting Jesus to meet you and for you to receive something from Him? Or did you come prepared to give Him your respect and your attitude, your gratitude, your adoration out of something that's already received? That's just one aspect of worship. There's yet another factor in determining perfect worship. It has a lot to do with the standards that you and I develop to make that assessment. And it's a question that Jesus poses in a parable. We find that parable in Matthew chapter 13. If you want to flip over to Matthew 13, you can do that. We'll put it up on the screen as well. But Jesus gives this very interesting story, a parable, right? A story that's meant to convey something else. It's a fictitious story, but it's meant to make a point. Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 through 9, and then verses 16 through 23. It says, later that same day, Jesus left the house, sat beside the lake. A large crowd soon gathered around him, so he got into the boat. Then he sat there and taught as the people stood on the shore. He told many stories in the form of parables, such as this one. Listen, a farmer went out to plant some seeds. As he scattered them across the field, some seeds fell on a footpath and birds came and ate them. Other seeds fell on shallow soil with underlying rock. The seeds sprouted quickly because the soil was shallow. But the plants soon wilted under the hot sun, and since they didn't have deep roots, they died. Other seeds fell among thorns that grew up and choked out the tender plants. Still, other seeds fell on fertile soil, and they produced a crop that was 30, 60, and even 100 times as much as had been planted. Anyone with ears to hear should listen and understand. All right, well, what does that mean? He doesn't leave us hanging. We get over to verse 16. Or verse 18, rather. Excuse me, verse 18. Now listen to the explanation of the parable about the farmer planting seeds. The seed that fell on the footpath represents those who hear the message about the kingdom and don't understand it. Then the evil one comes and snatches away the seed that was planted in their hearts. The seed on the rocky soil represents those who hear the message and immediately receive it with joy. But since they don't have deep roots, they don't last long. They fall away as soon as they have problems or are persecuted for believing God's word. The seed that fell among the thorns represents those who hear God's word, but all too quickly, the message is crowded out by the worries of this life and the lure of wealth. So no fruit is produced. The seed that fell on good soil represents those who truly hear and understand God's word and produce a harvest of 30, 60, or even 100 times as much as has been planted. Perfect worship is determined by the condition of your heart. So here we are. I mean, it all comes back to preparation again, right? What's the condition of the soil of your soul? Are you coming prepared to hear the truth and to respond affirmatively to it? Are you devoted to cultivating the soil of your heart all week long? Or is your spiritual vitality, the spiritual vitality of your heart, based on your presence once a week and on the conditions of what's going on in your life on that day? Have you prepared yourself through confession and repentance to hear the truth? And have you spent time daily in God's word in order to be able to respond to it affirmatively? Many people take the shortcut. I'll come on Sunday, I'll get a warm fuzzy, you tell me something from Scripture, I'll believe you. I'll feel pretty good. Maybe I'm challenged. And I walk out the door. I'll see you next week. Jesus always said to those who have ears to hear, let them hear and understand. He wasn't making a statement about physical hearing. He was appealing to our hearts. He was saying to those who are willing to listen in humility rather than pride, they will hear and understand. Is that you? Or are you already forming arguments in your head to defend your position on all the stuff that we've talked about here this morning that are so near and dear to your heart? Look, folks, this is not intended to be a guilt trip to make us all feel bad about how off course we've gotten in this area. It's intended to be a rudder to help steer us back on course. The idea is we want to be able to experience the level of deep intimacy with God when we come together and worship together. We want to be able to experience that. All of us have a longing for that in our heart. We want authentic worship, not something that's fabricated or manufactured. Perfect worship is clearly about the object of that worship, and we're not it. God and God alone is worthy of our worship. And any complaints that we might have surrounding our worship of Him has its origin in our displacement of Him as the object of our worship. Just like the people of Rome were doing. When we do that, we've taken God's place. Any dissatisfaction that we might have is in direct proportion to the amount of effort that we've placed in cultivating our soil of our heart all week long and in preparing with confession and repentance. You want to experience perfect worship? Then spend time focusing on the Holy One in light of your sinfulness. And in humility, confess those things to Him. Repent of those things from Him. Spend time talking to Him, listening to Him, before you even get here. That's how we can be ready for perfect worship, right? Keep focused on the proper object, not the style, the object. No matter what the style is, we ought to be able to worship. Prepare ahead of time. Spend that time daily. And when you do that, Scripture tells us we will ward off darkness and confusion. The foolish ideas, thoughts about who God is and how we should worship Him will go away. We will avoid a downward spiral in the way that we live our lives, that wedge, you know, create a wedge in our relationship with God. And our worship of Him, consequently, will be both honoring and fulfilling. To those who have ears to hear, let them hear. You know, we're prepared to celebrate the Lord's Supper together. Another act of worship. And it's one that Scripture tells us very clearly is one that we can come to when we have spent time confessing and repenting. One that we can come to with our praise and our adoration. One that purely focuses on God as the object of our worship. Because it was God in His grace, in His mercy, in His love for you and I, who looked into this world, who looked ahead and could see our sinfulness and could know that our relationship with him was going to be broken because of our sinfulness, and who loves us so much that he prepared, before the foundations of the earth, he prepared a Savior for us. A man who would come and who would take responsibility for all of our sin and would die for us so that we could have our sins forgiven through him. And he rose from the dead to conquer death so that we could live over the power of sin in our life. If we make him the object of our worship. So this meal is an opportunity. It is for those who have made the decision to follow Jesus Christ in their life. And maybe you're sitting here and haven't done that yet. It's not too late. If you'd like to participate in this with us, we invite you to take a moment right where you're sitting. Confess your sin before God. Repent of it. Invite him to be the Lord, not just the Savior of your life, but the Lord of your life. We will pass around the bread first. We ask everybody to take one and hold on to it. And we'll eat that together, and then we'll do the same thing with the cup when it comes by. Come. For now, all things are prepared. Jesus, in a desire to give his disciples and all of us something to remember what he has done by, took bread and broke it. And he gave thanks for it. And he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat it, do so, remembering me. The cup that we share represents the blood of Christ shed for you and me. In the same way that he had with the bread, he took the cup, he gave thanks for it, and he said, this is my blood, which is poured out for you. As often as you drink it, do so, remembering me. Father, we thank you for your tremendous gift of grace in our lives. We thank you, Lord, for your love, which is deeper than we can even begin to comprehend. We thank you for your forgiveness. Continue to teach us how to forgive one another. And Lord, we pray that, Father, that we will draw closer to you. Draw closer to you in our understanding to be able to lavish our admiration, our respect, our praise on you appropriately. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you to stand as we close our service together. When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth that'll bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
King of endless words, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, when it's all about about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've needed, but it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry.
You know what it's really about is communion. God wants us to commune with him, to be in relationship with him. Folks, look, man, I know probably a large percentage of us. I know that daily reading is probably a struggle. Maybe it's been hard to get into the habit of that. I get that. I know the idea of coming prepared to bring something is a new concept. I understand that. But man, if you are looking for an opportunity to really get something out of a Sunday morning service, I want to encourage you. I want to challenge you. Maybe it'll be the first time you've ever done it this week. But I really want to challenge you to embrace the opportunity to spend time daily in God's word, getting to know this God that you're going to come together and worship. To spend time understanding his holiness. And in doing that, recognizing your own sinfulness. And in humility, confessing that before him. Repenting of those things. Preparing your heart to come and to lavish praise and adoration on the one who saved you with a true, deep understanding of what it is he saved you from. And I promise you, if you come with that kind of heart, it doesn't matter what we do or how we do it. You will come away from service having communed with your God, entering into a deeper level of intimacy with him, which is what we all desire. Go in peace. May the God of love and peace go with you now and forevermore. Amen. Have a great week.